Welcome to tonight's meeting. My name is Leslie and I'm an alcoholic. Some of you are here because you're intrigued. You want to hear intoxicating stories of addiction, of alcohol and writing, whiskey and ink. Some of you will be here because someone dragged you. Yeah. And some of you will be sitting here thinking, I'm actually in the wrong place. I mean, I don't need to be at an AA meeting. I'm not an alcoholic. But then again, that's what someone that really should be here might think. AA is not a history of our personal success stories. It is rather a history of our colossal human failure. These are our stories of alcohol and writing, whiskey and ink, of human beings trying to piece our lives back together and failing. And trying again and again. I'll begin tonight's meeting by reading a small section from Alcoholics Anonymous, written by our founder, Bill W., in the mid-1930s. Our stories disclose, in a general way, what we used to be like, what happened, and what we are like now. If you have decided that you want what we have, and are willing to go to any length to get it, then you are ready to take certain steps. As some of these we balked. We thought we could find an easier, softer way. But we could not. With all the earnestness at our command, we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. Some of us have tried to hold on to our old ideas, and the result was nil until we let go. Absolutely. Remember that we deal with alcohol. Cunning, baffling, powerful. Without help, it is too much for us. Here are the steps we took, which are suggested as a program of recovery. One, we admitted that we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. Two, came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Three, made a decision to turn our lives and our will over to the care of God as we understood him. Four, made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Five, admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. Six, we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Seven, humbly asked him to remove our shortcomings. Eight, made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. 9, made direct amends to such people wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. 10, continued to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly admit it. 11, sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood him, praying only for knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry that out. 12, having had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. Or, as Russell Brand, an atheist, recently wrote in his book Recovery. 1, are you a bit fucked? 2, could you not be fucked? 3, are you, on your own, going to unfuck yourself? Honestly, tell someone trustworthy how fucked you are. 6, well, that's a lot of fucked up patterns. Do you want to stop it? Seriously? Now apologise. Unless that would make things worse. Stay connected to your new perspective. Look at life less selfishly. Be nice to everyone. Help people if you can. So before we move on to the sharing part of tonight's AA meeting, I would just like to say that if anyone finds that they're triggered at all by anything that's shared tonight, please do just take a step out and have a breather. That's absolutely fine. But if we all could just remember that if anyone does need to leave abruptly, it might just be because they really need the loo. Okay. No judgment. Well, tonight's meeting is now open. This is normal, by the way. We normally do just sit and wait for someone to start sharing.
Hello, my name is Stephen, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, Stephen. Oh, sorry, I probably should have mentioned. When someone introduces themselves, we always say hello, whatever their name is, at the beginning. So in this case, Stephen. And at the end, we say thank you, whatever their name is, when someone's brave enough to share. So get ready, let's have a go. Stephen, when you're ready.
Hello, my name is Stephen, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, Stephen.
Hi, Stephen.
At the height of my use, I was filling trash cans with beer bottles and doing so much cocaine, I had to stuff tissues into my nostrils so I wouldn't bleed on my typewriter. Even though I wasn't tackling my addiction, part of me knew I was an alcoholic and began to scream for help in the only way it knew how, through my fiction and through my monsters. I wrote denial into my characters. When I wrote The Shining in the mid-70s, I didn't even realize that I was writing about myself. Jack said, "Not me, I can stop anytime." That was me. But it was Misery, the story of a deranged nurse named Annie and her terrorized patient, the writer she holds hostage, that finally got me to quit. Annie was coke. Annie was booze, and I decided I was tired of being Annie's pet writer. But I was afraid, you know? I was afraid that I wouldn't be able to work anymore if I quit drinking and drugging. Thanks, Stephen.
Thanks, Stephen. So, what is a meeting? Well, it's just one life after another, an anthology held together by earnestness. It might start with an ordinary man. His name is Charles, and he's an alcoholic.
It has always been a hazard for me to speak at an AA meeting. When I was first in AA, I couldn't wait to get up to speak because I knew I could do better than other people. I rarely had a story to tell. I was more articulate. I could dramatize it, and I would really knock them dead. I took to it with great joy and ego and spoke all over the place. It didn't help me stay sober. But I'm forgetting our common starting place. My name is Charles, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, Charles.
Hi, Charles.
My story isn't much different from anyone's. It's the story of a man who was made a fool of by alcohol over and over and over, year after year after year, until finally the day came when I learned that I could not handle this alone. Nobody understands the alcoholic. They think he's a deliberate troublemaker, that he's having a good time, that he's doing this on purpose. I know otherwise. I know that he is sick, that he is helpless, that there is no answer for him in himself. And so in 1942, I decided to write a novel about this from the inside. I wanted to write it in such a way that every reader would know what was the matter with the hero, although he himself never did. I wrote this novel. It was called The Lost Weekend, and it was quite a success. It was called The Definitive Portrait of the Alcoholic, and it did me no good. For unstable characters like myself, success can be as difficult and dangerous as failure. I got tired of being my own hero. I remember lying in bed, thinking of my neighbors in their little houses down the street, and being keenly aware of how they envied me. But I also knew how much I envied them, because they had love in their lives, and I didn't. I didn't seem to be able to have it. It is true that I was living in the midst of my family who loved me. My wife did, my children did, but at the same time, I had no love because I couldn't love anybody. I couldn't get outside of myself, and I think this is the thing that plagues the alcoholic. I was too self-absorbed, too self-infatuated, and I drank. Are we really all that tormented? Or is it something we hang on to, foster, even cherish, till it becomes an end in itself, full of self-defeating interest? After years of doing sobriety on my own, I relapsed. It started slow and escalated. I had always looked down on people who were in AA, but now I was desperate. My doctor in the sanatorium made me attend. And you know what? I was enormously impressed by that first meeting. I can't remember what was said. What impressed me was that here were people who I had nothing in common with, except alcoholism. But that was a major bond because these people had been where I had been and had something that I didn't have. They were sober. I wanted it. I decided to really find out what it was all about, really give myself up to it, really listen, stop talking, stop performing, stop patronizing the groups with my little celebrity, and see what these people had. An old lady brought up a definition of humility that I love. She said that it is the quality of being teachable. Through AA, age 56, I think I am finally teachable. I have also gotten something that I never thought was possible for me. That is, to get outside myself. It is a marvelous reward.
Thank you, Charles.
Thanks, Charles. I'm Leslie, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, Leslie.
The first time I felt it, you know, the buzz, I was almost 13. I didn't vomit or black out or embarrass myself, I just loved it. I loved the crackle of champagne, its hot pine needles down my throat. We were celebrating my brother's graduation, and I wore this long muslin dress that made me feel like a child. Until I felt something else. Initiated. A glow. The whole world stood accused. You never told me it felt this good. Addiction doesn't surprise me. You know, it seems more surprising that some people aren't addicted to anything. From the night of my first buzz, I didn't understand why everyone in the world wasn't getting drunk every night. If I had to say where my alcoholism began, I might say it started with my first blackout. Or maybe the first time I sought blackout. The first time I wanted nothing more than to be absent from my own life. Maybe it started the first time I dreamed about lying about drinking. When the craving had got so deep, there wasn't much of me that wasn't committed to either serving or fighting it. In the early days of my drinking, a university surrounded by writers who drank, you know, and in the shadows of all those legendary drinkers, Faulkner, Fitzgerald and Hemingway, Poe and Baudelaire, Burroughs and his junkies, De Quincey and his opium, addiction seemed generative. You know, it seemed like interior decor, an accessory that spoke to inner depths. I believed that the person who found himself in that state of thrall was someone who felt things more acutely than ordinary men, who shared his living quarters with darkness. And that eventually, the drama of enthrallment became itself something worth writing about. My work followed pain like a heat-seeking missile. When I look back, I see someone hurling herself at the world, asking it to give her back to herself with some edges. Drinking promised a version of consciousness that didn't mean endless twisting and turning in the bedsheets of myself, tangled and restless, aching for dreams. But it was always just a temporary flight. When I returned to myself each morning, the groove of lack had just got deeper, more stubbornly etched, like a skip, skip, skip in the song. Drinking offered bliss and gave me shame. It promised dependence, but offered self-sufficiency.
This is boring. Get real.
It also felt really fucking good. That actually happened once, when I was speaking at a meeting. This notorious old-timer who was struggling with dementia shouted out how boring my share was. Oh. It never happened before, and I've never heard it happen again, but it happened this one night. Everyone just shifted in their seats. This man tapped veins of primal insecurity in me. I worried that my story wasn't good enough, that I'd failed to tell it right, that somehow I'd failed at my dysfunction. Yeah? Failed to make it bad or bold or interesting enough. This woman sitting next to me, she just touched my arm. A way of saying, don't stop. So I didn't. I kept going, stuttering, eyes hot, throat swollen, drinking completed me. There was nothing feigned about how much I loved that icy swell. That sense of so much to say. Escaping anxiety and fueling carefree adventures, but it led me to do some absurd things. I drunk and drove more times than I can count. I drunk pregnant before having an abortion. I drunk even though it conflicted with heart medication to treat my persistent tachycardia. I let a man fuck me because I was too drunk to resist. I had my nose broken. Throwing up during blackouts, bruises on my shins from stumbling upstairs, coke dusted under my nose like powdered residue from a slice of coffee cake. These legible residues of fairly unremarkable dysfunction. The sparkle faded. By the end, drinking was no longer electric. It was musty routine. The final night of my drinking was just the last ounce of pressure on something already broken. I came home from a bar, already drunk. My boyfriend Dave was asleep. I was relieved. I just wanted to keep feeling this righteous sadness, to keep feeling it alone. I filled a big red cup with straight whiskey. There are patches of time I don't remember. I remember panicking when I heard him knocking on the door, because I couldn't hide. I was too tired to try. He just asked me what was wrong. And I picked up the cup. It felt so good to show him it was there. The night of my first meeting, I drove across the bridge to an address near the hospital, just crying all the way. I sat in the car park, daring myself to go in. But in these rooms, I found a different relief. Just the inkling. This eerie immediacy of hearing myself spoken out loud. You know, these people didn't know anything about me, but they knew one part of me. The part that thought about drinking all day, every day, better than anyone else. Relief came from sitting still and listening. I heard stories as a writer for their themes and climaxes. But mainly I heard them another way. As a woman who still wanted to drink more than she wanted to do anything. Part of proving that you're truly ready to recover involves admitting that you don't know if you can recover at all. That's how humility gets built into hope. Old-timers sober for 40 years say, with any luck, I'll stay sober till the end of one more day. Recovery, it's about giving what you need yourself, not what you already possess. Your own fragility isn't a liability, it's a gift. In recovery, I found a community that resisted what I'd always been told about stories, that they had to be unique, suggesting instead that a story was most useful when it wasn't unique at all. When it understood itself as something that had been lived before and would be lived again. Originality wasn't the ideal. Beauty wasn't the point. Recovery has been about immersion in the lives of others. Mine is a book about the grit and bliss and tedium of learning to live in this way. Chorus. Without the numbing privacy of getting drunk.
Thank you, Leslie.
Hello, my name is David, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hey, David.
Hi, David.
I didn't want to come into recovery, but eventually I made a grudging move toward maybe acknowledging that this unromantic, unhip, cliched AA thing. So unlikely and unpromising, this goofy, slapdash, anarchic system of low-rent gatherings and corny slogans and saccharine grins and hideous coffee might actually offer something in all of that. The people listen because, in the last analysis, they really understand me. They have been on the fence of both wanting to get sober and not, of loving the very thing that was killing you, of being able to imagine life neither with drugs and alcohol nor without them. These people also recognize bullshit and manipulation and meaningless intellectualization as a way of evading terrible truths. And on many days, the most helpful thing they did was to laugh at me and make fun of my dodges and to advise me just not to use chemicals today because tomorrow might very well look different. Advice like this sounds too simplistic to be helpful, but it was crucial. I kept a list called Heard in Meetings. They say it's good for the soul, but I don't feel nothing inside you could call a soul.
I came in to save my ass and found my soul was attached. I shit myself every day for years.
The happiness of being among people. Just a person among people.
Thanks, David.
Thank you, David. A meeting takes you from one life to another. Easy as that. With a raised hand, no segue or apology necessary. Her name is Jean, and she's an alcoholic.
I was drinking hard in Paris when my infant son was hospitalized with pneumonia. I'd arrived in autumn 1919, 6 months pregnant, and spent my first afternoon drinking wine and eating ravioli at a sidewalk cafe. I've escaped, I wrote of that first day. A door has opened and let me out into the sun. We were young and poor, my husband and I, but we lived happily in a cheap hotel room. We made cups of hot chocolate and drank wine on the wrought iron balcony each night. Paris teaches you to forget, to let yourself go. But I let myself go too fully. I was never a good mother. I let my baby sleep in a little basket near the balcony door. And at 3 weeks old, he fell ill. I remember thinking, this damn baby, poor thing, has gone a strange colour and I don't know what to do. I'm no good at this. He was taken to the hospital and a few nights later, when the hospital said he had a severe case of pneumonia, I grew anxious because he had not been christened. My husband bought me the only thing he knew could calm me down, 2 bottles of champagne. By the time the first bottle was finished, we were laughing. The next morning, the hospital called to say my son had died at 7:30 the previous evening. He was dying, or was already dead, while we were drinking. I spent my life writing about drinking, but I kept drinking myself into oblivion anyway, a lifelong kamikaze dive. All the self-awareness in the world couldn't keep me sober. Whenever I've tried to escape this pain that has run through my life, it has reached out and brought me back. Now I don't try any longer. Women alcoholics are treated differently to men. If the mythic male drunk manages a thrilling abandon, the reckless, self-destructive pursuit, his female counterpart is more often understood as guilty of abandonment, the crime of failing at care. My drinking violated the central commandment of my gender. Thou shalt care for others, and revealed itself as intrinsically selfish. I do not know others. I see them as trees walking. I learned early that it was bad policy to say that you were lonely or unhappy, and the characters in my books are the grotesque versions of what I always feared I would become. A pariah, who drove everyone away by showing the intensity of my unhappiness. If I stop writing, my life will have been an abject failure. I will not have earned death.
Thanks,
Jean. In a meeting, we often take a little break. It can be quite intense. So this is a break, and you can have a little chat with your neighbour. But you can also take some quiet time to reflect. In this break, we also have the next share, which is a poem. So if you just want to have a little look at that during the break, her name is Elizabeth, and she's an alcoholic. And there's biscuits.
Thank you.
Biscuit, you were just like, oh, do you have to wait?
There is another pack as well, so you're not going to miss out.
I don't know.
Amy died. One journalist reflected that her death forced the public to choke a bit on the rock mythology that had been crammed down our collective throats. The tortured genius, the hellion libertine, the martyr dying for the noble cause of nihilism. It was unending, our collective fascination with the self-inflicted pain of a beautiful woman. Sometimes a meeting is stories of struggle, of failing and getting up again, of striving and trying and hoping. But other times, old-timers with years of sobriety make you believe it's all really possible.
Hello, my name is Raymond, and I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, Raymond.
Hello, Raymond.
For half my life, I ran on booze and fumes, leaving meals unfinished because I was getting all my sugar from liquor, walking out of restaurants before I paid the bill, moving classes to bars, calling my students and colleagues late at night. I sat engrossed at my typewriter, writing the comic's tale of a bender into its ruthless wisdom. I was never into the mythology of drinking. I was into the drinking itself. During the worst of my drinking, I was spending $1,200 a month. And even sober, years later, I still wanted to give up friends, love, starry skies, for a house where no one was home, no one coming back, and all I could drink. For a few months, I went to AA meetings once or twice a day. I tried, not always successfully, to maintain my balance on the wagon. The turning point came on the 29th of May, 1977, when I was offered an advance for a novel. I was in the middle of a bender at the time. But 4 days later, I took my final drink. If you want the truth, I'm prouder of that I've quit drinking than I am of anything in my life. I'm a recovered alcoholic. I'll always be an alcoholic, but I'm no longer a practicing alcoholic. I've lived two different lives, one drunk, one sober. In the first, my writing was something that happened despite the drink. In the second, I tried to learn my craft as a writer, how to be as subtle as a river current when very little else in my life was subtle. It took me at least 6 months after I stopped drinking before I could attempt to do any more than write a few letters. Mainly, I was so grateful to have my health back and my life back that it didn't really matter to me if I ever wrote anything again. I was just very happy to be alive. Eventually, I published books of short stories and poetry. Some of them were successful. I had a thing for this cold water. Just looking at it made my blood run and my skin tingle. It pleases me, loving rivers, loving them all the way back to the source, loving everything that increases me. I go on, yes, go on. One day at a time, shoveling snow.
Thank you, Raymond.
Thank you, Raymond. So, as we come towards the end of the meeting, we always close by saying the Serenity Prayer together. Don't worry, we're not expecting you to know it or say it individually. If you just turn to the back of your programs, it's just at the top there. So if you'd like to turn to that now, and we're all going to say the Serenity Prayer, if you wish to, together. All the biscuits. Ready? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference.
Hello, I am Billy, and I'm an addict.
Hello,
I'm Amy. And I am an alcoholic.
Hello, I am Marcus.
Hello, I'm Keith.
John.
Dennis.
Malcolm.
George.
Richard.
Ernest.
Scott.
Jack.
And I'm an alcoholic.
And I'm an alcoholic.
And I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, I'm Leslie. I'm an alcoholic.
Hello, Leslie.
Told you you'd get used to it by the end. Drinking has always been two things at once. A set of disrupted neurotransmitters and a series of stories we've told about dysfunction. Addiction becomes a contagious epidemic, a willful abnegation of civic duty, the valiant rebellion against the social order, or the noble outcry of a tortured soul. Depends on who's doing the telling and the using. When I wanted to write a book about recovery, I wanted every story to wear its sobriety like a shimmering supernatural gown. But sometimes, a story is just a thing someone needed to say, or a way someone needed to fail. I've been so eager to dismiss the myths of whiskey and ink that it took me a while to stomach their truths. That yearning is our most powerful narrative engine. And addiction is one of its dialects. Addiction is a primal and compelling story, structured by irony, hinged by betrayal. It's the fantasy of escape colliding with the body in ruin. But still, it makes me wonder, is there any objective metric for how much brilliance might be required to redeem a lifetime of damage? Might we have been more? I used to ask my own diary, am I an alcoholic? When does ordinary craving become pathology? Now I think when you want to stop and can't, and try again and can't, and try again and can't. When I ask my diary, drunk, am I an alcoholic? I was looking to see if my pain was real. As if drinking more would make it incontestable. Of course my pain was real. Just like everyone's. Of course, it wasn't quite like anyone's. Just like everyone's. For just being such a beautifully connected and generous audience. That was the very, very first time that we've done Whiskey and Ink, and it was just beautiful to share it with you, so thank you so much. These were just some of the stories taken from Leslie Jamison's incredible book, The Recovering, Intoxication and Its Aftermath. It's fascinating, compelling and insightful, and it's part critical essay, part biography, part eye-opening look on things that you always thought you knew but never actually dared to delve into. So we have copies of this book available to buy, would you believe, just in the tent outside here. And tonight we do actually also have a limited edition signature stamp from Leslie Jamison herself, as well as other books, another book by Leslie Jamison, a collection of her essays called The Empathy Exams. If you're interested at all, please do grab a copy. It's well worth reading. This has been a Story Machine production. You can follow us on Twitter @story_machines or on Instagram with the same handle, or check out our website storymachineproductions.co.uk. Once again, thank you so much for being just such a lovely audience. Have a wonderful night. Thank you.